Hey everybody, I do apologize for the less than ideal lighting today, but it's snowing where I live. It was 91 yesterday, and today it's 35 with snow flurries. Everybody, welcome to my channel if you're new, and welcome back if you're returning. My name is Maya, and today we're going to talk about how I manage all of the stuff that I do in my life as a high schooler in America in 2020. The majority of my audience falls between the age range of 18 to 24, which I think is funny because I'm not 18 yet. But even if you are not in high school anymore, I think these tips could apply to you, specifically if you're in college, but really even beyond the academic world and into the professional one, because the majority of these are going to revolve around how to be more productive and ways to pursue what you love. So a little bit of background about my high school experience, where I am now, and what I am doing. So freshman year, I changed schools, I changed districts, and I went to my state's most acclaimed performing arts school. My major there was creative writing. It was a really good time, but ultimately it wasn't the right school for me just because I have so many interests and I wasn't quite ready yet to pigeonhole, in this case, what form of art I wanted to pursue. So for my sophomore year, I moved to the school I'm currently at, which is a public school in my original school district, and it's a school with about 3,000, 4,000 kids, so it's pretty large. Even though I really loved that my original high school, my freshman year high school, was really small. I knew every single person in my class. What's beneficial about having a larger school is that often the array of classes that are provided and offered is much wider. I am a junior now. I'm 16 going on 17. Life's pretty chaotic, not only because of obviously 2020, COVID-19, pandemics, chaos politically, socially, every which way, but because junior year in itself is just kind of a lot. I am taking 4 AP classes this year, which are AP Language and Composition, AP Statistics, AP US History, and AP Biology. This is also my 4th or 5th year of World Language, which is Spanish for me. Also chaotic because, of course, junior year is the year that you at least have to start thinking about and preparing for tests such as the SAT and the ACT, which, although they don't have supreme power over the trajectory of your life, they do really have a heavy influence on what colleges you'll get into, what schools you'll get into, things like that, if that is the path that you are taking. But I still make time for what I love. So let's get into my extracurriculars. I have a lot of them, why I've picked them, how I am formulating my resume for college to fit me particularly, and really what you can do to be more productive and pursue your own passions. Before I dive into my extracurriculars, I will say that none of this was possible for me last year because I was struggling really severely with my mental health. So remember, please, that productivity is often only possible if you're doing okay, if you're doing well mentally, physically, etc. You have to take care of you before you take care of work that you are assigned. In fact, I actually have a 504 disability plan. I'm legally disabled because of my mental illness. So if you are struggling and it's really hindering your ability to work at school, I would definitely suggest looking into what accommodations would best suit you so you're able to succeed more thoroughly. Okay, so my extracurriculars, here we go. I'm very heavily involved in the theater community at my school. I've been in the musical every year that I've had the opportunity to be in it, and I've been in several plays. This year, theater is a bit on the line, so let's talk about what I am able to do this year and how I'm really capitalizing on what is available to me given COVID-19. I feel like there's this misconception, and one I had as well, that to have extracurriculars and to really build a strong college application, you need to do activities through your school. That's just simply not true. What I do instead is I find extracurriculars that I can pursue on my own that are really particular to me, my interests, and the path I want to take in the future. I do, of course, realize that I'm kind of the exception here in knowing what I want to do. A lot of high schoolers don't. A lot of college students don't. A lot of fully grown adults don't. And I have no doubt that for me, my interests and hopes and ambitions will continue to morph throughout my life. That said, my current trajectory is film. I want to be a film director, cinematographer, editor, screenwriter, really anything that I can do in the world of film. I'm even interested in animation. Here are my extracurriculars. extracurriculars. I narrate audiobooks for Learning Ally as my volunteer job. I've actually only been with Learning Ally for probably 2 or 3 months. I already have 25 hours of volunteer service, and it's volunteer service that I'm passionate about because education is really important to me. And it's really important to me that students with learning disabilities or people who are visually impaired are able to have the magic of books available to them. I would highly recommend that you try to find a volunteer opportunity that fits into something that you are actually genuinely interested in and passionate about. For a really long time, I volunteered at my local memory care center, and although I loved helping the people there, I knew that I was not necessarily super interested in going that direction with my life. It was a great way to help people and an awesome way for a younger person to get started in volunteering, but as I did more research, I was able to find volunteering gigs that were more fitted to me and my interests, and that I hence felt that I could do better at and be more productive in. I'm also a listener for Learning Ally. I listen to completed audiobooks for errors, edits, and help really with the production side of things. Then, of course, I have my YouTube channel, and I would actually recommend that pretty much anyone start a YouTube channel. If you're interested about something, if you have a niche, something you're passionate about, you should make videos about it, because chances are people will eventually start watching what you're doing. And even if they're not, you're at least creating content. You're creating a portfolio that demonstrates that you're willing to put in the work and effort into YouTube, and that you have interests, that you're a fully fleshed human being, not just a piece of paper, not just your GPA. And yes, I did say work and dedication. YouTube is a lot of work, and I don't think people realize that. I certainly didn't when I started this channel, but for each video that I make, I spend probably 20 to 30 minutes filming and up to 8 hours editing in post-production. My next extracurricular is kind of a job, but kind of not, and that is publishing short stories. As I said, my freshman year, I went to school particularly for creative writing. It's something I really, really love and something I'm good at. Writing is an ability of mine that I actually feel really confident in and love to share with other people. So when I have the time, I will write a short story. I will go through all of the editing processes, and then I'll submit to publications. It can be kind of hard at first, especially if you're a teenager, to find where you can get your work published, because even though more people than you would think submit work as teenagers, there's just not a huge market for it, especially if you want to get paid. My work has been published in the Canvas Literary Journal, which has since gone extinct, as well as the Blue Marble Review. The Canvas Literary Journal did not pay me for my work, it was just kind of a you get a free PDF thing, but Blue Marble Review does. I got $25 for my short story, which will be coming out in September. Because it's so difficult to get your work published, either because there are not a lot of opportunities for teenagers to get published, or because maybe you're still working on your craft, as I constantly am, I started a blog. I did start this blog in like 2016, 2017. I was in 7th or 8th grade, and I think I started it the day after Christmas. Originally, it was a health and nutrition blog. Gradually, it has morphed, as my interests have, into a stream of consciousness blog. I post just kind of cultural critique and criticism, I'll write some research papers occasionally, and it's not something I update regularly anymore because YouTube now occupies the majority of my time. However, I have almost 200 posts on my blog, and that's a lot of content that I can look back on and be proud of. I'm also effectively managing my own business. Despite the fact that I'm not paid for my blog, it's pretty darn small, I am managing everything about it. I figure out everything from rough drafts to editing to titles to finding appropriate stock images and crediting creators. And really, I just talk about whatever I want. It's a wonderful outlet for me, let alone something that I can put on a resume and be proud of in years to come. Then I have my Redbubble shop. This is relatively new, and so far I have made no money, but that is okay because I know that it'll take both time and exposure, and I also personally need to work on being more confident in promoting my own work. On my Redbubble shop, I upload artwork that I've made, whether it be digital or hand-drawn, painted, charcoal, and I have the ability to sell it in the form of stickers, t-shirts, phone cases, laptop covers, etc. Here are a few of the pieces that I have made and uploaded devoted to my Redbubble shop, and if you're interested in looking at some of my art or even purchasing it, I will have the link in the description box below. My shop is called Empathy Studio. Now, here are some things that aren't necessarily extracurriculars, but are ways that you can pursue your passion and tie it into your academic life. Be very, very particular about the electives you're choosing to take at schools if you're fortunate enough to have electives. Don't just take ceramics because you think it sounds fun. Well, actually, maybe do. Then you'll be exposed to something that you might turn out to love. But my point here is, if you know what you want to do, if you know what you're passionate about, try to pick your classes and structure your schedule around that. I'm taking animation classes this year, and I'm taking a class that gives me free rein to really do whatever I want artistically, and I've set goals and objectives for myself. For me, that looks like producing, editing, filming, directing 4 to 8 films this school year. I want to animate at least 1 or 2 of those, and the rest I want to experiment with different types of film, whether that be just the traditional, you know, I do that because I have a DJI Osmo. I guess this is more accurate. To audio quality production, I want to work on that. I want to try silhouette animation, all sorts. Pixelated animation, there's just a variety of things I can do. So really, I guess my tip here is that if you have a general idea of what you're interested in, try to fit that into your academic life. If you want to be a journalist, take a journalism and broadcasting elective. Be a part of the school paper, of the school literary magazine. If you want to go into construction or construction management like my little sister, maybe try technical theater, where you'll have the opportunity not only to build things hands-on, but to be a leader among your peers. Ultimately, my recommendation for extracurriculars is to pursue what you like. You don't need a wide variety of stuff. It's actually better, specifically for college applications, though hopefully that's not the only reason you're doing this stuff, to be focused on a particular niche. It's okay to experiment, but if you have kind of a general idea of where you want to go and what you're really passionate about, go for it. So, how do I manage to do this all while taking a lot of really challenging classes and maintaining a good GPA? I don't know sometimes. It seems like it's a ton of stuff and somehow I get it all done, but I'm also a huge procrastinator. So here are my procrastination master tips for you to be productive. Oh man, what an oxymoron. I always see the videos about like Elon Musk, just these like really famous guys that have been really brilliant and instrumental to society's functioning and foundation. And they always say like they wake up at 5 a.m., they wear a black t-shirt and jeans every day, they have a very set routine. No, that doesn't work for me, and that's okay. I like clothes. I think fashion is really fun and it's a good way to express yourself. Also, there's no way that I'm voluntarily waking up at 5 a.m. I will say, however, no matter when you wake up, find a schedule that works for you. To perform at your best, you need to figure out what helps you feel your best, and that's going to be different for everyone. You can't just watch my YouTube video or any other YouTube video and get a generic answer, because it's gonna be different. I also mentioned this one previously, but I want to re-emphasize it because I cannot express how important it has been to me. Gotta take care of you. Also gotta fuel your body, right? And that's something that I've actually had to work really hard on because I've suffered from eating disorders in the past. You gotta move your body. I like to go on walks. You gotta do things that are fun for you and really stimulate you creatively and mentally and emotionally. And I was missing all of that from my life. So please, before you like put a ton of pressure on yourself to start really being productive and engaging in work that you love, make sure you're taking care of you. That's really where good work starts. My last productivity tip is, again, pretty generic. This is kind of a generic video, but it's one that's held really true to me and I thought I'd share. That is write everything down. Everything. Everything. I write everything down. I write down my homework. I write down test dates. I write down project due dates. I also write down fun things that happened that day or an adventure I went on. I journal every night. That's been really important for me. Self-reflection and introspection are really great. Meditating is awesome. That's not writing, but I feel like it fits in there somewhere. Just find a method of organization, I guess, that works for you. For me, that's writing stuff down. On that note of being organized, make sure the space you're working in or having fun in, those two things might intersect. Hopefully they do. Make sure it is clean. Some people actually do function better in a messy space. My sister is one of them. I cannot function in a messy space. My room is pristine to the point where it looks like no one lives here, which is kind of sad, and I might fix that in our new house because we are moving soon. More on that later. At the end of the day, what's important for productivity is to make sure that everything in your life is suited to you, and it'll take time to figure that out, and that's okay. To rehash, the biggest tip I have for being productive in high school and really setting yourself up for success after school, whether that be going into college or straight into the workforce, pursue what you're passionate about if you have the opportunity to do so. I know that's a privilege, but if you in any way can start working towards your dreams and your goals and having fun while working, do it. Thank you all so much for watching my incoherent rambling of the day. I hope it was helpful in some way, whether you're going into high school, you just graduated, you're going into college, or you're in your professional life and just kind of want to be re-inspired to do what you love. I hope you all are doing well, you're staying relatively safe and happy, and I will see you again on Saturday for a fun video, if I do say so myself. Yeah, that's all I got, so bye-bye.